amigos, ¿cómo están? Estamos aquí en una edición especial. Vamos a hablar toda la hora completa, los 60 minutos, autos 060 de autos eléctricos, híbridos, plug-ins, baterías, todo lo que tiene que ver con esta tecnología que nosotros creemos que es nueva, pero en realidad no lo es tanto. Así que prepárense porque vamos a hablar un poco de la historia de los autos eléctricos, vamos a hablar de los nuevos modelos, lo que son la Toyota, el Prius, el Chevy Volt, Nissan Leaf. Vamos a hablar del auto que está causando sensación en este momento, el Tesla Model S. Y vamos a hablar un poco también del futuro del auto. Y para eso, now we're going to switch back to English because we have our guest, which is an honor for me to have you here with us, Lindsay Brooks, Senior Editor of Automotive Engineer. How are you, Lindsay?
I'm fine, Javier. Thanks so much for having me.
No, it's my pleasure to have you here. And as I said in introduction in Spanish, we're going to talk all about electric cars. But before we start, let me make a little introduction about Lindsay, who is one of the main experts in the field. But let me explain how I came with this idea. We go to these trips, with media trips. We go and test drive cars. A lot of journalists come in and all that. And I hope I don't insult anybody, but this is true. And I think you're gonna second me on this, Lindsay. You go to these trips, and then you have dinners, and you have like a little bit of socializing before the presentation, before and after the presentations. And some people, some journalists, don't have too much of conversation. They talk about the car they're driving now, the car they're driving next, the trip they went last, and the trip they're going next. But then there's other people like Lindsay, who you might see, you have the luck to sit on the same dinner table, and even though in this occasion, there was someone being between us, but you were listening to his voice and the things he was saying, the question he was asking, and I thought to myself, wow, this guy knows a lot. So that's how I came up with this idea, because it's really very interesting topic, and of course, one of the top accessories in the industry.
Well, thank you so much, Javier. I mean, I've been a journalist for over 30 years and covering mostly advanced vehicle technologies for various magazines. And of course, the SAE magazines published by the Society of Automotive Engineers, our readers are the people actually developing these hybrid and electric cars. So this topic, Javier, is kind of complimentary here, but this topic for me is kind of like drinking from the fire hose. I just love these topics, and I love this whole subject area of electrified vehicles.
No, but it's true. I mean, another particular night, we were at the Volkswagen Jetta hybrid event, and you were, I mean, we had the engineers, one of the engineers in our table too, and the conversation was pretty interesting because we think about this new technology, and it's not that new to begin with. I mean, Ferdinand Porsche and Henry Ford developed electric and hybrid cars like more than 100 years ago, right?
And it's absolutely right. I mean, electric cars have been around really since lead-acid batteries, since somebody thought, I'll take a lead-acid battery and electric motor and I'll put it on my horse-drawn buggy and get rid of the horses.
Yeah, exactly. And I think one of the famous quotes from Henry Ford is that if he had asked people, they would just like wanted a faster horse or a bigger horse, right, instead of a regular car. But so the technology has been in there for a long time. It's been developed. So what happened? Let's start with the history. What happened after the first cars were developed with the batteries, and then they basically disappeared?
Well, they did, but back 100 years ago, let's say the 19-teens, electric cars, Javier, actually competed almost directly with combustion engine cars, and there were also steam-powered cars at the same time. And of course, you know, we think today that if I have an electric car, where am I going to go charge it? Well, back in the beginning of combustion engine cars, where am I going to get the gas? I mean, it wasn't like there was a gas station on every corner. So these three technologies competed really up until the late teens, when one big factor, which was like a tsunami, and that was the Ford Model T, came in, and Ford drove the prices down on the Model T. So if you wanted a car, there was a car for you. It was very affordable.
Yeah.
And really, it was the Model T that killed the growth of electric cars in the early days. And you know, some cities, Detroit was one of them, but other cities were hardwired for electric car charging. There were charging stands, kind of like we have parking meters.
Wow, even back then?
If you, If you owned a Detroit Electric or a Woods Electric or a Baker Electric, to name three popular electric cars, you drive down the street and say, there's a charging stand, and pull right up and plug your car in. And that's kind of where we're getting to today.
Well, that's incredible because also in part of the history, Ford also worked with Thomas Alva Edison developing one of these cars, right?
Well, exactly right. And the appeal back then was kind of like the electric starter was, you know, early gas engine cars where you had to be a guy. You know, you had to turn the crank and advance the magneto and pull the choke and, you know, get these cars started. They didn't always start. Well, electric starters came in to make it easy for women to run combustion engine cars, but at the same time, there were electric cars, battery electrics, and the company sold these to professional people, to doctors, and also to ladies because they were quiet, they were smooth, there was no gas, there was no oil, there was no emissions. The same thing we're going through today.
Yeah. I was remembering when you were mentioning about that they were selling only to men, but I believe that the wife of Carl Benz, who actually is the inventor of the car, most people think it's Henry Ford, but it's actually Carl Benz, in one trip, his wife drove it, and she stopped at the pharmacies to get more fuel for the car, and that was the way they did it back then. You said that they were in gas stations, so that was the first trip, the longest trip they did, thanks to that way of getting some fuel at the pharmacy, right?
Well, that's right. They would go in, and I think you probably bought gasoline in a glass jar. You talk about a fire hazard or dangerous. Yeah, you would go in, and it wasn't like there was a gas station on the corner, so you'd say, where's the pharmacy? And go in and say, can I have a liter of gasoline?
Yeah, imagine that today. A little bit also in that era, or maybe a little bit later, Porsche developed one hybrid car, the Semper Vivus. I remember they showed it, I believe it was in the New York Auto Show a couple of years ago, and I think they were celebrating the 100-year anniversary of that car. That was a fantastic car. So the hybrid electric car concept was also going on in that time, right?
That's right, Javier. We can credit Dr. Porsche, the famous sports car guy, he was 23 years old. In 1898, he built the world's first electric car that had front-wheel drive. And this car, instead of having a traction motor, it had electric motors in each wheel, each of the front wheels, and they propelled the car to a battery. About a year later, he followed it with the first hybrid, which had an internal combustion engine, which spun a generator, which again, he used his wheel motors. It was all-wheel drive. He had a wheel motor in each wheel. And this car, this hybrid car, in 1899, could travel about 40 miles on electric and gas power, which was a real big deal back then.
Which is what the Bolt can do nowadays, right? With only the electric battery, which is incredible, really.
You're right. It's funny how things take a long time to progress, and sometimes 100 years later, it seems like you're really not any farther than you were.
Yeah. So then they died. I mean, basically, from the 20s on, they basically died, and there was all these conspiracy theories in the 70s and the 80s about GM producing electric cars, and they killing them because the oil companies didn't want the business to go out, and they're back now.
Well, that's right, but there was a gap, and let's go backwards a little bit. 1970s. Javier, you remember a U.S. Clean Air Act came about, and the first CAFE fuel economy standards. Also, California, California was just dying with smog back then. So we saw the first regulations of air quality in the 70s, and this caused the industry and engineers to reinvestigate hybrids and EVs. So they had kind of been dormant from the 20s through the 70s. About 40 to 50 years they were dormant. And then everybody started to say, well, maybe this, let's look at some patents, let's look at what's been done. Maybe this could be one of the solutions. So that was the 70s. And then we got to the 90s, and we saw two things happen. One was cheap gasoline, and this caused the truck and the SUV boom to happen. I mean, gas was, as people used to say, cheaper than bottled water.
Yeah.
So why not own a truck? Why not own a big SUV? And that was
awesome
fine
car,
because it was, you know, fuel was cheap. But at the same time in the 1990s, we had that, and we had a renewed focus on battery development. And if you remember, the Clinton administration in 1993 challenged the U.S. auto industry to develop what they called the PNGV car, which was the Partnership for New Generation Vehicles. It was a government-sponsored plan to create an 80-mile-per-gallon five-passenger sedan. And GM, Ford, and Chrysler all developed concepts for this. And these cars, to get to 80 mpg, they were advanced hybrids. Now, the ironic thing about this PNGV program in 93 was only the Detroit companies were invited to participate. Now, legend has it that Toyota wanted to participate and felt that they were snubbed by the U.S. government. So what did Toyota do? Their leadership embarked on their own hybrid development program, resulted in the first Prius, which was introduced in Japan in 1997.
That's
and not
amazing.
To be outdone, then Honda picked up on that, and they entered the race in 1999, with the Insight. So it's ironic that the U.S. government was saying,
let's do it,
and then the Japanese did it. Even though the industry is just booming, selling big trucks and SUVs, the government said, you know, I want you guys to start investigating, you know, low-emission, high-efficiency vehicles. And the end result was that the main competitor, Toyota, got a lead on everybody else. I mean, I think that's one of the greatest ironies in the history of the industry.
Yeah, amazing. And that's going to be the topic of our second segment, because believe it or not, we are already done with one segment of the show. And by the way, CAFE doesn't stand for coffee, which is the word in Spanish. It stands for Corporate Average Fuel Economy. So just that.
That's right.
So it's not coffee, it's coffee for cars, I guess, or something like that. So when we come back in the next segment, we're going to talk about the development of the Toyota Prius. We're going to talk about the Chevy Volt, the Nissan Leaf, and all the new cars that are coming in, because there's a lot now. The LA Auto Show is coming up, and they say it's going to be like 20, 25 new models that they're going to be showing there with all this new technology. So don't go away. Lisa, please stay there, and we're going to talk about these all the cars when we come back. Esto es Auto 060. Aquí estoy. Yo soy Javier Mota. Acuérdense que nos pueden seguir en facebook.com Cristina Radio. Y continuamos con nuestro show especial de autos eléctricos, híbridos, plug-in hybrids. Ya regresamos.